Good afternoon, everyone. It's truly an honor to represent the Latino authors here in the state of Illinois, and to be able to be honored to represent all Latino authors across the United States. And although the numbers are small, today we stand strong and we stand proud. I'd like to thank the Honorable Secretary of State Jesse White for allowing us the opportunity today to stand on his shoulders so we can turn that key and open the door to a whole new world for the Latino authors to follow. I salute you.
This is Chicago's very own WGN News at Noon.
His journey through life has taken him from the very bottom to the top. And Robert Renteria has chronicled his life journey in the book From the Barrio to the Boardroom. Robert Renteria, thank you. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us. You know, your childhood could hardly be considered a fast track to success. Grew up in the barrio of East L.A. You were a high school dropout. You were in gangs. You dealt drugs. You used drugs. And then there was a turning point in your life. Tell me about that.
What happened when I was about 17 years old, my real father, my biological father, died in a halfway house on Skid Row. He was a heroin addict. And I went to see where he lived, and it was that where I realized that if I continued down that path, that would have been me. So I resolved from making better choices. I joined the military.
When I wrote the book, it was supposed to be my way to give back to our culture what was given to me by our culture, which is persistence and pride. I didn't know that when I wrote this book that it was gonna take off on me. I was just gonna write a book, put it on the internet, and it was gonna inspire and motivate people that way, to help them understand that they too could break that vicious cycle of poverty and live off their hopes for the American dream. And I was done, right? I did my part. I wrote a book. What else can you expect of me? You know, I was wrong, and I was pretty naive back then, because it was on January 11th of last year that I got a phone call that forever changed my life. There was a lady on the other end of the phone. She says, "Are you Robert Renteria?" And I said, "Yes." She goes, "I just read your article in the Beacon News." Now, the Beacon had come to my house, and they did a profile, right? And they put an article in the paper, and she goes, "I have a question for you." And I said, "Okay, what's that?" And then she paused, and she started to cry. And after about 15, 20 seconds, I said, "What's wrong?" And then she said, "I'll never forget." She said, "Robert, where have you been? Where have you been?" You know, I remember standing there with chills up and down my spine. I realized that not only was I not done, but my life with this book and the journey had just begun. I want you to know that this book, From the Barrio to the Boardroom, although it has my name on it, Robert Renteria, this is not the Robert Renteria story. See, this is your story. This is our story. This is a story of a lot of people in this room and all over this great city, and all around this wonderful place we live in called the United States of America, who've worked hard and who've made a lot of sacrifices and have done whatever we needed to do legally, mind you, to come out clean on the other side. This book is about hope and about dreams and about ganas o concito puede mental. Yes, you can if you believe. And if we believe, we can overcome seemingly impossible obstacles. I know. In this book, to you students here today, this book is going to teach you the secrets to success. This book is going to teach you about hard work. It was and always is the secret to success, because there's no shortcuts. You cannot just put powder in a glass and stir it up and have a pocket full of dough. It doesn't work that way. The second secret to success is determination. That's what got you here. You wanted it bad, and you got to want it bad as you get older, because life is tough. The third secret to success is education. Bright futures are built on a strong education. Your education is going to be the secret to your success of your future. It's going to be the passport to your future. It's going to be the key to opening doors for the rest of your life. And then when you get older and you go look for a job, you're going to realize that equal education means equal pay, and it levels a playing field, and it's a great equalizer for any race. For any race. As I stand here today, I think of a word. The word's called character. See, character is not just doing what's right when somebody's watching, but character is doing the right thing when nobody's watching. And that's what you did. Because when you got out of school, some people went left, and you went right, which was the right way, and you went home, and you did your homework, and you studied, and you earned your way here. That's the difference between winners and losers, and you're winners. That's why you're here.
I want to ask all of you to stand with me and help me raise this child up. This child represents all boys, girls, men and women alike who are walking around lost in a culture of darkness, and right now we're going to do something about it. Help me to lift this child up so this child can spread his wings and he can fly like the angel God had intended him to be. I believe that this book is going to change lives. Truth is already has, and it already is. This book changes lives. I believe all of us, one race, a human race, can help to change the world. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Robert Renteria, and I'm here to help make a difference. Gracias, que Dios te bendiga. I love you. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Westmont High School. I'm Steve Carr, and I'm the principal of the high school, and I'm very excited by this opportunity that we have to present to you today. Doesn't happen without quite a bit of effort. I'd like to thank our English department, our media specialists, our reading specialists, and the many staff members who are involved with putting this together today and making it possible for Robert Renteria to join us this afternoon. I want to give you a little background on Mr. Renteria before he gets started, so that you have a context for why he's here talking with you today. Robert J. Renteria Jr. is a successful businessman turned offers challenging individuals and organizations to help him put copies of his empowering memoir, From the Barrio to the Boardroom, into the hands of at least 1 million at-risk children and adults who need it. Supported by congressmen and mayors, Princeton University professors, and Barrio and ghetto middle school teachers alike, Robert's message is universal in that everyone has the right to live the American dream. Renteria came from humble beginnings, growing up in an impoverished East LA barrio and abandoned by his drug and alcohol addicted father. As a teenager, he became involved with a tough street crowd, used and dealt drugs, dropped out of high school, and went from one dead-end job to another. However, upon learning that is a strange choice in his life, after going back to his GED and then honorably serving 7 years in the United States Army, he moved to Chicago and talked his way into a job at a laundry management and sales company that eventually led to a position as vice president of a publicly traded company in the New York Stock Exchange. His success has convinced him to strike off on his own, and he has now dedicated his life to sharing his story with thousands of other people around the world so that they too can help break the cycle of poverty through education, hard work, and determination. Robert has given keynote addresses to the Hispanic National Bar Association in Chicago, the Illinois Legislative Latino Caucus Foundation, and the Chicago Public Schools. He has been profiled in major media, including Univision, La Raza, Hispanic Executive Quarterly, WGN Adelante Chicago, and numerous newspapers and magazines. It is my distinct pleasure to introduce to you this afternoon, Robert Renteria Jr.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Are we on? Hello, Westmont. Give it up. Hello, Westmont. How many of you in this room have read From the Barrio to the Boardroom? Show of hands. Show of hands. How many of you like the book? How many of you in this room read the book and said to yourself, I saw myself in the book? Something about the book reminded you? Right there in the corner. You read the book. What was it about the book you said, that's me? Right there. Yeah.
Just struggling and like trying to make the best of these situations.
See, this book, like you saw in the video, although it has my name on it, it's not the Robert Renteria story, it's your story. This is our story. I wrote the book for you because I wanted you to avoid taking those detours that I took in my life. This book is written for you so that you can make better choices. People ask me, Robert, why'd you write this book? And I tell them, you see, Oprah Winfrey says, tell your story so we could all be healed. And it was about 7 years ago, I pulled up in front of a local tavern. It was a bar restaurant. And there was a young guy out front. He says, hey, your car's fat. I said, my car's fat? He goes, yeah, your car's cool. He goes, how do I get one? I was driving a brand new Mercedes at the time. So I invited him in to come in and have a beer with me. At the end of the beer, you got a picture that he's got these big brown hungry eyes. And he says, So what's your secret? I said, get a napkin and a pen from the bartender because I want you to write something down. He took the pen and the napkin. The first word he wrote was hard, and the second word he wrote down was work. He looks at the napkin, he says, hard work? That's the secret? And I said, that's the secret. Now, he looked a little confused, but he put that napkin in his pocket. He reached out, he shook my hand, he ran out that door like I gave him gold. And I realized, you know, there's a story here. We have children and teenagers and adults alike that are walking around lost in a culture of darkness. I said, I'm going to do something about it. So I wrote this book. I'm going to take you back in time a little bit. My mother, when she got married to my father, see, she didn't know that he was doing drugs. She was in love with his good looks and his smooth-talking ways. But after a few months, she found vials of heroin in the toilet tank or behind the dresser. And she was scared to death. Who wouldn't be? She was petrified. My father squandered away all the money we had. He'd go to the pawn shop just to support his habit, to buy those drugs. At the age of 3, my father left the family, and the only legacy he left us was a pile of bills and a bunch of empty bottles of booze back in the trash can. But my mother, she persevered. She kept us together as a familia. I have memories of my mother taking Tupperware containers and putting milk in half, and the other half was water, just so there'd be enough milk for me and my little sister. What I learned about my mother, the most important thing in life is family. You protect it, and you respect it, and you don't abuse that privilege. When I was 6 years old, I had a terrible accident. I was at the carnival. I was getting off one of the ride called the Octopus, and it hit me in the head, and it lunged me some 50 feet. And I was lying there on the ground, bleeding to death. After I got to the hospital, they did a surgery. I was in the hospital for like several weeks. And I had to go, after that, I went to a handicap school for the physically disabled and the mentally challenged. I had to wear a football helmet. When I was 9, my mother remarried. Now, she married a hardworking guy, but the guy was abusive. He was a bad drunk. And he used to beat on me till I was black and blue. And I was just a little guy, right? What was I going to do? So when I got old enough, I ran away. But let me tell you one thing about that man that I do respect him for. See, he was trying to raise 2 kids that weren't his own. And that's a real man. Because see, anybody could make a baby. But a real man is there to raise those children and take care of those children, and that's a real man. So I quit school when I was in the 11th grade. And I started running around with some pretty bad people doing some pretty bad things. 17 years old, got a phone call that my father died on Skid Row in a halfway house. And I didn't know who he was, so I went to see him. So I went to the front desk and they gave me a key. And I went through the hallway of the flickering lights, it was stale smelling, and there were prostitutes, pimps, alcoholics, reaching out and asking me for money. And I got to the door and I'm shaking like this, and I put the key in the door and I turned it and I opened it real slow, and it was like deja vu. That same man who had left me when I was only 3 years old had left me again with nothing more than a bunch of empty bottles of booze in the trash can. See, a lot of people think you can control drugs and you control alcohol, but they'll always, no matter what, take control of you. And my father's death proved to me that if you play with the devil, you're gonna get burned. So I spent the next couple of years like a dog, chasing his tail, running in big circles, until my grandfather grabbed me by the throat and he sat me down. He said, mijo, he said, you gotta get out of here. He goes, I'll bet you that in 10 years, if you come back, these same guys you're running around with, your so-called friends, your peeps, are either gonna be dead or in prison. So I went back and I got my GED, and I joined the military. And the military not only changed my life, it saved my life. It taught me about leadership, about integrity. It taught me more about hard work. And I thought I was ready, right? I had traveled all over the world. It was great. I was just telling the story a few minutes ago that when I got to Germany, they wanted to go downtown to get a bite to eat, and they had taxi cabs. The taxi cabs were, guess what? They were Mercedes-Benz. I had never been in a Mercedes. So I realized, you know, there's a big world out there. So I went back to Los Angeles after I honorably served 7 years in the military. I was a Green Beret and 3rd Special Forces Group at Fort Bragg. I went back to Los Angeles, and guess what happened? My grandfather was absolutely right. The same guys that I was running around with had elevated their game to dealing heavy, heavy drugs. Some of them were killed in drug violence and gang violence. The other ones were doing hard time in a federal penitentiary, looking forward to what, 3 hots and a cot? That's not why God gave us gifts when we were born. So I decided to leave again. So I came to Chicago in 1990 with $200 in my pocket and a big duffel bag that I carried, and I got a friend of mine had an apartment in Lyle, and I slept on his floor. put some blankets down there, some pillows, and that was my bed. And back then, I could only afford Arby sandwiches, 5 for $5. And I'd buy those sandwiches. I had one sandwich a day, and I cut this sandwich in the morning in half, and at night I eat the other half. And I drank a lot of water till I got a job, you know. But I got that job, and I said, I want to be somebody. I want to be somebody. And I worked hard every day, every weekend, every holiday. I didn't see my parents for years because I was going to be somebody. And after 6 years of dedicating my life, working hard, I became vice president of a publicly traded company on New York Stock Exchange, and I didn't finish high school. But I will say to you that if I had to go back and do it again at today's time, could it be done? Likely not. I was at the right place at the right time. I took my shot. But today you need that education. You saw the video. Equal education means equal pay, and it levels the playing field. It's a great equalizer for any race, for any race. So in 2001, after I climbed that ladder of corporate America, I decided I want to take the shot. I want to open my own business. I had saved some money. I put together a business plan, and I was ready. So in 2001, I opened up my company. The company was called WashPro. It was a commercial laundry distribution company. We built laundromats. And then I said, you know what? I want to write this book. And I'm glad I took that shot, because my grandfather told me when I was younger, he didn't want me to be one of these old men sitting in a bar having a shot like this. I wish I would have. I wonder if I could have. So I want to talk to you a little bit about taking the shot. There's a story about a young boy, young man about your age, about 35 years ago, who came home after basketball practice crying. He went to his room, he closed the door till the mother came home, and she said, what's wrong? And the young man says, I didn't make the basketball team. She says, so why are you crying? He says, because I want to be on the team. She said, then you go back tomorrow and you try again. So the young man went back the next day, he tried out for basketball again, and guess what happened? He didn't make the team again. He came home again crying. She says, you get back off and you try again. So he went back the next day, and he made the team. And that same young man who made the team turned out to be the greatest basketball player of all time. You know who that is? Michael Jordan. Who can tell me who missed more shots than anybody in basketball of all time? Shaq? Who else? Magic Johnson? The person who missed more shots than anybody in basketball of all time was Michael Jordan. See, nobody talks about the shots that he missed. They only talk about the shots that he made. So you can't be afraid to take the shot. You have to get in the game. You always miss 100% of the shots you don't take. Okay? And it's okay if you miss that shot. I'm here to tell you that you're not going to make all those shots. And you're not going to win every single game. I want you to do me a favor. Take your right hand and put it over your chest, over your heart. You guys feel your heartbeat? If anybody ever asked you, I have some advice for you. If anybody ever asked you, I want you to tell them that Robert Renteria told me this. Don't ever, ever, ever let anybody ever tell any of you that you can't do something. Because as long as we have a heart, as long as we have a corazón, we always have a chance. We always have a chance. It doesn't matter how many times you're going to get knocked down, right? What matters is how many times you can get up and fight. And I'm not talking about with this. I'm talking about with this. Okay, let's talk about having a plan. How many of you here today have been on a road trip with a family, gotten in the car and taken a trip? Show hands. What's some of the first things you do when you get ready for your trip? You pack your clothes. What else? You get food. You get gas. What else? Okay. Somebody said a map. Who said map? Okay. Why do you need a map? Okay. You need a map so you don't get lost. So you know where you're going, right? Okay, your life is the same way. You have to have a plan. Okay, so you can map it out from point A to point B. Otherwise, it's like playing darts blindfolded. You always miss 100%. You'll always miss 100% of the shots of shooting darts at the wall is playing, it's like shooting darts blindfolded, okay? So you can't hit a target you can't see, and you can't reach a goal you don't have. So you gotta have that plan. Life's not easy. You need to understand the secrets to success, okay? You saw the video. Hard work, dedication, and education, those are the secrets to success. Okay, so we talked about taking the shot, having a corazon, and having a plan, and having the secrets to success. But in the end, it's up to you. So I don't want you guys, when you leave here, to think, well, that's just one guy, he had a good story, and you know, that's pointing fingers and blaming other people. Only children and cowards do those things, okay? So you have to, so as they say, you have to man up to the table and take responsibility for your actions. This book that I wrote here from the Barrio is about making the right choices. My grandfather told me years ago, I'm gonna give you this advice, and it's important. My grandfather said, you show me your friends, I'll tell you who you are. So you make sure you're not running around with the wrong people. Okay, surround yourself around good people who can help elevate you and lift you up so that all of you could spread your wings and fly like the angels God intended all of you to be. You know, I look in your eyes and I don't see teenagers or I don't see kids. I see hope and I see dreams. I see possibilities waiting to happen. I see the future leaders of our community and of our country, because that's what you represent. You are the future leaders of this country. How many of you have little brothers and sisters? Has anybody told you, has anybody ever told you that all of you are role models? If they haven't told you, you are. Your little brothers and your little sisters are gonna, they're gonna follow you, and they're gonna wanna be you. So you have to make sure you're setting the right examples. You know, tonight when you go home, there's two things I want you to do for me. One of them is when you say your prayers, I want you to ask God to give you a big enough throat to swallow your pride. And I want you to ask for help. See, pride's a good thing. Pride makes you strong. Pride moves you along, gives you that edge. But pride also can hurt you because there's a lot of good people who want to help. And if they don't know you need help, you're not going to get that help. And you need to use your resources, by the way, that are here at your fingertips at your school and your community. There's a lot of people here who care, your faculty, your parents, the stakeholders of this community, they care. They have a lot of vested money and interest in your future and the success of your future, so you need to make sure you ask for help. The other thing I want you to do tonight is when you go to sleep and you dream, I want you to dream, and I want you to dream big. You know, I got a few more minutes, I'm gonna leave this open for questions. I want you to read that up on the screen. And I want you to read it with me. Don't let where you came from dictate who you are, but you let it be part of who you become. Okay, one more time, please. Don't let where you came from dictate who you are, you let it be part of who you become. There's one important thing, please. I want you to make sure that you respect your roots, okay? Be proud of your heritage. Be proud of where you came from. Okay, you hold your head up high. You don't hold your head down for anybody. Okay, can you please pass this chair up here? We've got a few minutes. And I want to open this up for some Q&A. So anybody that has any questions regarding anything you want to ask me, the book, about yourself, about life, or advice, please feel free to ask.
Robert, one of the things in some of the classes, some kids have crafted a few questions, and I'm going to have Julian ask you the first one just to get things started.
My question is, are you aware of anyone who has turned their life around because of reading your book?
The question was, has anybody changed their life after reading my book? You know, I'm more humbled than anybody to tell you that the impact that I'm seeing in real time is absolutely amazing. We have teenagers who have read the book who are in gangs, who get out of gangs, and they separate themselves because they realize that gangbanging is not a lifestyle, but gangbanging is a death style. We have other students, to the question, who've read the book, who are getting B's and C's or not getting A's and B's. Or other students who, like me, who had quit school, have gone back to school, or others who weren't even thinking about going to college or not going to college, and other young men and women who are proudly and honorably serving our country today as a result of reading the book.
Roman's got another question here.
Are you still friends with any of your old gang friends, and did you ever give an old friend a job?
I moved from California to get away, and I have not associated myself with anybody in Los Angeles that I once ran with. I take my own advice. You show me your friends, I'll tell you who you are. So I myself surround myself around good people, okay, who want to help me go forward and not pull me down. Because there's a lot of haters out there. For those of you who read the book, there's a lot of people that think that you call them your friends, but as soon as you get a little edge ahead of them, they want to pull you back down, just like the crabs in the bucket.
Now that we've gotten things started, does anyone else have a question they'd like to ask? Sam.
If you place so much importance on the value of education, why'd you decide not to go back to college after you got out of the military?
Good question. When I was in Europe, I took college courses at night, and I've taken some junior college courses since that time, and I'm currently planning on going back to school come this fall. That's an excellent question. I got a question over here.
What advice would you give to somebody who's like struggling in like a gang?
Oh.
Shut up.
Hey.
Okay. Like if somebody's in a gang now and they're trying to like they want to get out, like what advice would you tell them?
The message of anybody that's in a gang or that wants to get out is like I said a second ago, you know, gang banging is not a lifestyle, it's a death style. And if you're running around with the wrong people, you're going to find yourself at the wrong place at the wrong time and get yourself killed. Okay, so I'm gonna ask you to please don't be a statistic. Okay, the bright futures are built on a strong education. Advise that person to go back to school or stay in school, or like I did. I'm not telling people to use the military as a resource to get out, but I endorsed the military, it worked for me. So, you know, if, at the very least, ask for help. The educators in this community and in this school, they're there to help. So if you don't ask for help, then that person may be lost. So I'd advise them to ask for help.
We have another question back here.
Robert, did you ever wish that you would have had a relationship with your biological father?
You know, my father's, I didn't know who the guy was, and yes, I really wish I would have, because there's nothing more important in life than family. You know, if I can go back and do it again, I would have told him to please stop doing the drugs. You know, please get away from the alcohol. You know, but you know, that was a life and the choice that he made. That's the direction, like I said a few minutes ago, you play with the devil, you're gonna get burned. But yes, I really wish I could have had the opportunity to know my father. But I think that his death was a wake-up call for me, because if I continued down that path, that would have been me.
Robert, I think we have time for at least one more.
I just wanted to know if you never went to the military, do you think you might would have changed and you still would have wrote your book?
You know, there's no way to know what would have happened. All I know is that the military saved my life. It changed my life. I'm grateful for it. I endorsed them and made me a better man because of it. You got time for one more?
I have a question for you. With the difference between urban and suburban, are you finding a difference as you go to various areas like inner city schools and suburban schools? Are you finding a difference in the type of issues they face and the type of student?
The issues of life are universal. You know, whether or not somebody's willing to talk about it, acknowledge it, I think those who are in denial and saying we don't have those kind of problems, they're not helping the cause. I think that we need to be the leaders that we are and face those issues head on and collectively collaborate to make things better for all communities. The book is not about age, race, religion, or economic background. The book is about one race, the human race. We're running short on time. I know we got to get to go here, so I want to ask you to work with me here. Westmont, are you with me? Westmont, I want you to know that I love you and there's nothing you can do about it. I wish all of you success and never less. Gracias.